I'll just show you the images of the patient.
So clinical features. Clinical.
This is the 30 years old male, and he has got a left sided recurrent shoulder dislocation.
Right.
And he has got almost 10 to 15 episodes of dislocation. His apprehension test is positive. And you see the X-ray here. You know, put up on the image. AP and the lateral view, the axial view. So they're almost normal. Only in the axial view you can see us.
We cannot see the axial view. Yes.
Here, yeah, you can see a Hill Sachs, you know, small lesion you can see.
Right.
Otherwise, generally, normally you don't see anything on the X-ray. Now we're coming to the MRI.
Okay.
Yeah, the axial cuts, you see a anterior labral tear here in this image.
Yes.
Okay, so the plan is to do an arthroscopic Bankart's repair for this patient.
Okay.
And we'll see the posterior whether the Hill Sachs also needs to be addressed or no.
Yeah.
The patient is actually already induced, so we're just waiting for the talk to get over so that we can start.
No, the talks are over and you can just start off.
Okay, I'll connect you to Mihir now.
Yeah.
Mihir will describe you the setup and the position of the patient.
Fayaz?
Yeah.
You all have finished lunch?
No, this is simultaneous lunch.
So you all
no
need
problem.
To be NBM for two more hours now, okay?
Yeah.
Okay, so we'll show you the position. Patient is in lateral position.
Okay, which one is this, left one?
It's a left shoulder. Lateral position, that's it. You can see the picture of the patient lying down lateral.
Good.
Okay, so this is the left shoulder, this is the head end.
Yes.
That's the leg end. Okay.
Okay.
I'm going to stand posterior to the patient and my arthroscopic tower is anterior.
Okay.
Okay, now you are seeing this traction device. So we discussed in the morning that in lateral position you need some kind of balanced traction.
Right.
So this traction device has wheels.
Right.
Okay, so it's not a static traction, it's a balanced traction with 4 kilograms suspended on the other end.
Okay.
Okay, so it's a balanced traction. Okay.
Right.
Now,
how much is the angle?
Okay, so the angle, if you see, zoom out, about I usually start at 45.
Right.
And if I want intra-op, my assistant will just make it about 60, 70 as per need.
Okay.
Because the problem is if I keep my angle high, there is a chance of brachial plexus traction injury. So I don't want, I keep it at 45.
Right.
And as and when I'm working at 5 o'clock, 6 o'clock position, you'll just, you know, pull it up.
Yeah.
To distract the glenoid from the humerus from the glenoid.
Okay.
Okay. Again, please understand the patient is not in a dead lateral position. He's in a floppy lateral position.
Good.
Okay. So we are taking advantage of the retroversion of the glenoid. So the glenoid is parallel to the floor.
Right.
So my orientation is perfect. Okay.
Right.
Now a little about the setup. The station is anterior. The anesthesia work trolley is at the head end.
Right.
Niche. Okay.
Yeah.
Thoda niche lele. Yeah. So the anesthesia work trolley is here. Now the issue is we need 270 degrees of arc when we are doing a shoulder.
Yeah.
So I need this area free.
Right.
Okay. So I shift the anesthesia trolley on the anterior half.
Right.
My workstation is anteriorly.
Right.
Okay. And then I keep a little Mayo's trolley here, which is stuck to the patient where all the electronic wires are kept.
Correct.
Okay. So all the wires from the station will come and go onto the Mayo's trolley.
Right.
So this has only my electronics and optics, nothing else. No metal
Correct.
Instrument.
Correct.
Then if you go behind, this is my back trolley.
No, we cannot see that. Yeah.
Okay. Good. That's my back trolley. Okay, so it has instruments starting from the general instruments, okay,
right.
And the specific arthroscopic related instruments.
As and how you
yes,
keep
so
getting
all my
them, right.
And then I have my box which has my standby instruments ready inside.
Right.
Okay, so that is what we start with. So now we'll shift to the portals the way I've marked.
So just explain
yes,
us
yes,
the portals.
Yes, we'll do that.
Yeah.
Okay, so I've already marked the portals. Okay, so we are looking at the left shoulder. The first thing to palpate is the anterolateral acromion, first thing, the most prominent. Fayaz, you with me?
Yes.
Okay, so I'm going to mark a little dot here, anterolateral acromion.
Right.
Posterolateral acromion and
right.
Make my lateral acromial border.
Great.
From there I go down the spinous process.
Right.
Then I go down anterior acromion and the anterior
yes.
clavicle.
Perfect.
Okay, then I'm going to place my finger in the navicular region.
Right.
And mark posterior clavicle and the superior part of the scapula.
Yes.
And this is my AC joint.
Right.
Okay, then I dip my finger down from the lateral one third of the clavicle to get the coracoid.
Yes,
okay,
along the concavity of the
absolutely,
clavicle.
Absolutely, the concavity.
Yes.
Okay, and you always palpate it, no wonder how obese that patient is.
Correct.
Now, portals. So this is my basic skin marking and we discussed in the morning that you need to mark because what happens over a period of time, there is extravasation and then you cannot palpate the bone.
Correct.
Okay, so my primary posterior portal, my primary viewing portal is my primary posterior portal.
Right.
And that's the only blind portal that I make in my entire procedure.
Correct.
So typically it's about 2 cm distal and 1 cm medial in the posterior soft spot.
Right.
Okay, posterior soft spot. Then anteriorly if I go, I have two portals anteriorly. I have an anterior inferior or an anterior mid glenoid portal.
Yeah.
Okay, which is just lateral to the coracoid.
Right.
Also understand, I cannot go inferior to the coracoid or medial to the coracoid.
Correct.
Because that is the danger zone. So whatever work I do is going to be lateral and superior to the coracoid. I cannot go into the danger zone.
Okay.
Because there are all the vessels over there. And right. My second, third portal is my anterior superior portal.
Correct.
Which is just the off the anterolateral. So I'll put my finger, I'll just roll my finger, and when my nail comes, I'm going to make my antero superior portal.
Correct.
So for a routine Bankart's repair, in this case is a recurrent dislocation.
Okay.
MRI is showing an anterior labral tear, approximately what I understand from 2 o'clock to 6 o'clock. Let's see what we see inside.
Right.
So we are looking at an anterior capsulolabral repair. So we can manage with these three portals. If I'm doing rotator cuff, then we need to make some portals here, but then I think we'll restrict to only Bankart.
Okay.
Because then rotator cuff goes into an advanced course, right?
Right.
So we'll go in now, stab knife. So again, very important, especially in shoulder, that your blade has to be tied, especially in shoulder, okay, because we're looking at deep structures.
Correct.
Okay, so we are going to go. So again, I'm feeling my soft spot.
So is your first portal same for all cuff surgeries as well?
Yes, absolutely. So any surgery, understand, we have to see the joint.
Right.
So this portal is always constant for even... Yeah.
So even for the cuff, you start with...
Yes, always. I'll enter, there are 2-3 reasons for that. Number one, I need to check glenohumeral joint for the level of arthritis.
Right.
Okay, in a cuff surgery, because usually patients are elderly. Number two, they have chondral issues, so I take care of that. Number three, they are stiff, I will do a capsular release. And number four, I need to check the subscap tendon.
Right.
So these are the indications. I will do a glenohumeral scopy before I do a subacromial scopy. And more importantly, very small tears you cannot see from the subacromial side because of the bursitis.
Correct.
So you check the tears from the glenohumeral side, pass a needle, pass a ethylon, mark it.
Yes.
So that's easy to identify when you go up in the subacromial space.
Yes.
Yeah, okay. Faya, secondly, I always use an arthroscopic irrigation pump.
Yes.
In
how
any
much
shoulder.
Is the, how much is the pressure?
Okay,
that
so the presently the systolic BP is 100 systolic.
Right.
So I would usually keep my pump pressure about 20 to 30 below it.
Okay.
Okay.
Mihir.
Yeah.
Is it just GA or you have also given some sort of block?
So it is interscalene.
Correct.
Plus GA, and I always insist, and I think it's very good intra-op also for BP control because it has good analgesia.
Right.
And post-op patients are very comfortable.
Correct.
Okay, and what we do is, tell me fast.
Intraoperatively, is it something to do with the field also?
Absolutely. See, what happens the moment there is analgesia, your pulse doesn't go into tachy, there is less bleeding, your BP is normal.
Yes, so
okay.
I hope everybody is understanding what he said. So what he said is that if we are giving interscalene anesthesia block before giving GA because the patient should not move in the position. Okay, so when he gives the block, there is good field, so less amount of bleeding is there. Okay, and the GA with GA he can also have control over the BP. So less amount of GA is required, and post operatively the patient is having less pain.
Okay, and we always try to keep BP around 100.
Okay.
Nothing less than that and nothing more than that. And
okay.
Usually, I think the anesthesia team is using Dexmed.
Right.
And they have inhalation also.
Yeah.
So things are very well controlled. So I usually don't have to see at the station once we start.
Which company pump you're using, Mihir?
I'm using all indigenous today. So
great.
I'm using Medtronic.
Yes.
Okay.
So it is a very good pump.
Secondly,
I'm
using the Smith & Nephew 560P system.
Wow.
I think we have Sheila Bain from Lions Club there. Ganesh?
No, she's not there.
Ganesh? Okay, fine. So I'm using the Smith & Nephew optical system.
We have Ketan Bhai from Lions
Club. Oh yes, Ketan Bhai is there. Fayaz, before I start, I really need to thank Lions Club.
Yeah.
Especially Ketan Bhai, I've been in conversation with them.
Yes, he's listening to you. He's listening.
Yeah.
And
can you focus on the station?
He's listening to that.
Can you give the mic to Ketan Bhai if you can come on mic, please?
Yes.
Station.
Mihir Bhai, thank you so much for appreciating this.
Ketan Bhai, you need to be there for 5 minutes more.
Of course. I'll be all through the case
possibly. The station. Fayaz?
Yes.
So we work in a municipal hospital, okay? This is not a private hospital.
Correct.
And Lions Club has been very instrumental in helping us in whatever kind of help we want, okay?
Yes.
So we, so presently my entire arthroscopic tower, okay, which includes the monitor, which is Smith Nephew, a high definition camera with a light cable, has been donated by Lions Club.
Very good.
Is about 2 or 3 months back.
Fantastic. And I think there should be a good hand on that.
Absolutely.
Thank
absolutely.
You so much.
Yeah. Ketamai, thanks a lot. If you could convey this to your club.
Absolutely. Yeah.
And the morning case we did also, we use your system. We are using your system even now. Mm. Okay. And this system is going to record the surgery. We're going to distribute it to delegates. So it's going to help in learning for the future generation as well.
Yes.
Thanks a lot, Ketanbhai, once more.
As I always say, you know, equipment is only a means. It's all the work that is being done that is really appreciable. Thank you so much.
That's, thanks, Ketanbhai.
That's your kindness, yeah.
Okay. Fayaz.
Yeah.
So now I've established my portal.
Yes.
And my skin, the incision is only skin deep.
Right.
Okay, because I don't want to cut muscle, I want to split the muscle.
Right.
With my sheath, which is atraumatic. Okay.
Yeah.
So this is my only step which is going to be blind.
Yeah.
The only step is the first portal. Okay.
Yeah. So how much would be the size of the incision?
So my incision is about 5 mm because my sheath is 6.5 mm and we know tissue can stretch.
Yeah. Yeah.
So it's a 5 mm stitch and our 11 number blade is about 5 mm. So I just let the 11 mm blade go in and come out. So it gives you a nice 5 mm cut.
Right.
Okay. So I'm entering the sheath and I'm directing it towards the coracoid. So my finger is on the coracoid and my sheath is directed towards the coracoid. Okay. Okay. So now if you can see, I can feel the humeral head. Can you
yes.
see the movement?
Yes. Yes.
And I can feel the glenoid.
Yes.
I feel the glenoid. I feel the humeral head and I can feel the space in between.
Yes.
So I've parked my sheath tip in that space.
Yes.
Now next what I'm going to do, I'm going to direct it towards the coracoid.
Right.
Moment I direct it towards the coracoid, I know I'm at the equator of the glenoid.
Correct.
Now I'm going to ask Mars to give distraction gentle, so it just opens up a little bit. Okay.
And this is a blunt trocar.
This is blunt, absolutely blunt. You can't use pointed because it's going to damage the cartilage. Okay.
Right.
So once more I'm feeling the humeral head. Can you see the movement of my sheath?
Yes.
I'm feeling the glenoid, I'm in the gap and now I'm directing it to the coracoid and gentle round pressure and I hopefully get a pop. Yeah, so I got that pop. Okay.
And then whether you are in the subacromial or in the
yeah.
glenohumeral joint, so how do you
exactly
know that?
So if I get a pop, the pop is of puncturing the posterior capsule.
Correct.
If I'm subacromial space, there is no capsule.
Correct.
So this should be in the sub glenohumeral space.
Yeah.
And also I can feel my humeral head and I can feel the glenoid.
Yeah.
However, I'll now finally confirm when I go in with my telescope.
Correct.
Okay.
Correct.
So this is a 6.5 mm sheath. It is a high flow sheath.
Mihir, Samir here.
Yes, Samir.
Have you put a do you put the lateral traction ever?
No, Samir, I don't use lateral traction.
Okay.
Because the only time that we need lateral traction is when we are working at 5 o'clock to 7 o'clock.
Correct.
Okay, that is when my assistant just gives a little auxiliary traction or puts a little roll. And again, it is a matter of practice and your training. Okay, so now you see, I have not started irrigation fluid at all.
Yes.
Now, Fayaz, one tip for the delegates.
Yeah.
Everything around the shoulder is red because it's muscle. The only thing white is the joint.
Correct.
Okay, so if you see anything white, you know you're in the joint.
Right.
Because the cartilage is white, the bicep is white. Okay, the rotator cuff tendon is white, everything else is deltoid muscle. So now you see it is, you can see white color?
Correct.
Okay, that means I know I'm in the joint. Okay,
now.
So that's one trick. If you see only red muscle fibers, you plus withdraw
yes.
and go in again.
Right.
So I'm going to start irrigation fluid now. Pump on.
And please orient us with the position.
Yes, I'll do that. Pump on, middle button, yeah. That's it. So we've started irrigation fluid, you can see the bubbles coming in. And the first thing I want to look is for the biceps tendon. And that's the biceps tendon. Can
yes,
you see it?
Yes.
So the biceps is like the post or the police officer. Okay, he's always there at the gate. You always have to encounter him
lighthouse.
First. Lighthouse. That's right. I was forgetting the word fires. Thanks. Okay. So beautiful. Okay. The joint shoulder is a beautiful joint to see. So you
yeah.
can see the biceps tendon there. Okay. Now to orient the floor or the floor is the glenoid. You can
right.
see the white floor.
Yes.
And you can see that arc from 1 o'clock to 9 o'clock. That's
yes.
the humeral head.
Yes.
So I'm going to move the
so
humeral head. Yeah.
Here the orientation of the joint is just as the patient is lying down. So
absolutely.
We are looking from posterior.
Yes.
The way patient is lying down, glenoid
yes.
is inferior
yes.
and the shoulder, the humeral head is superior.
Yes.
And on the right side that we are seeing is the biceps tendon. So
that's right.
So
that's
far,
right.
I think everybody is clear about it.
Okay. Fayaz, if you have a pointer, you could show them on the monitor there.
Yeah.
We have a marker pointer there, a laser point. Okay.
Yes, yes.
So this is the biceps.
Yes.
This is the glenoid, that's the humeral head.
Yes.
You can see anterior labrum there.
Correct.
A little tear at about 2 o'clock position. So my prediction was correct. Okay.
Correct.
You can see the labrum is a little different, and then there is no labrum here till right 6 o'clock.
Yes.
Now
so
moment
it's a
I
big
go,
card.
Moment I start going 6 o'clock. See, we are giving a little lateral traction, and you see the opening. Leave the traction, please. See, it closes once I leave the traction.
Yes.
Moment you give traction, you can see it clearly. So whenever you're working from 5 o'clock to around 7 o'clock, you need this traction. So you see by five. At about 6 o'clock, the labrum is there. Can you see that?
Yes, yes.
So
I'm pointing for my delegates.
So, as per my MRI interpretation, we have a deficient labrum from 2 o'clock till about 6 o'clock.
Yes.
Okay, so it's very important that as orthopedic surgeon, we should be able to read the MRI.
Correct.
Okay, so now this is 7 o'clock labrum, this is 8 o'clock, this is 9 o'clock, 11 o'clock, and back to the biceps, 12 o'clock. Okay, so that is a clock phase. Okay. Now, this is the humeral. You can see on the top, I'm showing the supraspinatus tendon. Can you see?
Yes. And
okay.
This is intact.
Yeah. So everything behind the biceps tendon is supraspinatus.
Yes.
Okay. And this is the rotator interval tissue. Because
correct.
This is the subscap tendon. Can you see the subscap tendon?
Yes.
There? Okay. Going from 6 o'clock to 12 o'clock.
Yes.
So the interval between the anterior cuff, which is subscapularis.
Correct.
And the superior cuff, which is supraspinatus, is called rotator interval.
Correct. So this
now,
area full.
Perfect. Okay. So this rotator interval, I can make 2, 3, 1 portal as much as possible because
correct.
I don't want to damage the cuff here
correct.
Or the cuff there.
Right.
Okay. So with this, now I'm going to try establishing my first antero-inferior portal. So I'm going to use a 18 gauge pink spinal needle. I've already done my surface marking, which is lateral to the coracoid. So I'm going to do a little dimpling. You can see the dimpling there?
Yes.
Yeah. And I'm going to go in with the needle.
Yes.
Let's see where it comes out. My target is as high as possible.
Correct.
And as close to the subscap as possible. Okay.
Correct.
Let's see. There. Okay.
Yes.
So, I'm not happy with this. The reason is I have to work at my anterior glenoid.
Correct.
And I'm almost tangential. So, I'm going to go higher up.
More superior.
Yeah. So, I'm going to remove this needle.
Yes. More laterally.
I'm going to go more lateral. That's correct. I'm going to go more lateral. I think that should be fine.
Yes.
So I'm getting a good angle and I'm going to use the curved all suture anchor, so it gives me an advantage, okay?
Yes.
So this is going to be my antero inferior anchor.
Yeah.
Portal, and I'm going to establish my antero superior. Second needle. So I always pass my needles before committing to them so that I can avoid cannula crowding.
Yeah.
So this portal from outside is just off the anterolateral corner. Inside it is going to come in the region of the biceps.
Right.
Okay. So I'm going to dimple there. It's going to come there as a little defect that has been created when I entered.
Right.
Okay.
So what is the trick for this second portal?
So this second portal, see that I came from there. I managed to get into that only.
Yeah.
Okay. So the trick is you want to, whenever you make your portal, see that your needle is pointed towards the glenoid.
Correct.
Okay. And then you go in smoothly and it is in region of the bicep. This is the bicep tendon.
Yeah.
Okay. I can in fact come a little more posterior as well because I like it absolutely skirting the there.
Yeah.
So this is what I want. Okay.
Yeah.
So this is my portal
yeah.
for watching and this is my portal for working.
Yeah.
Okay. Any
so
questions?
Which side are you going to keep the biceps?
I'll keep the biceps in between.
Okay.
I'll keep the biceps in between. Okay?
Any specific reason?
Again, a matter of habit for us. Just a matter
okay.
of habit.
Okay.
Okay. So what happens is when I keep it here, I don't like it.
Okay.
Just a matter of habit.
Okay.
Okay. Fine. Fine. So I'll take a stab knife now.
Yeah.
And we'll now. So I make a portal. I take the needle right down to the capsule. So I do a capsulotomy. Okay.
Right. So just see, he is keeping the needle there,
yes.
and along the needle he is passing his knife. So that the direction is not wrong. So, yeah. So, he will precisely come at this target area.
So, Fayaz, what has happened is, because
yeah.
I made this rent in the rotator interval here,
yeah.
there has already been extraversation anteriorly.
Okay, okay.
So,
that's
I'm finding my blade a little short. So, let me see how I'll manage now. Hold the camera, please. Hold the camera. So my entire blade has sunk in and I'm struggling a little bit to get it off now. Artery.
Yep. So or else you can just take the skin and the
soft
tissue and
so
then
now
directly
this is why
enter
that
with the
thread tied by the sister comes into my rescue.
Yeah.
Okay. Hold this. Yeah, so blade came out, okay, because only because the thread was tied.
Correct.
Otherwise this blade would have gone in.
Correct.
So I'm just going to make the portal a little bit bigger.
See the importance of tying the blade in arthroscopy.
So we faced this problem, all of us have faced it.
Yes.
And we learn from our own experience, okay. See that, so that's my portal, okay.
Good.
So absolutely where my needle is, you need to be very accurate.
Yeah.
See, I've not damaged the subscap tendon, so my
Fantastic.
Cutting edge is this side.
Correct.
I'm skirting the subscap as high as possible in my rotator interval.
Yes.
So I can nicely go down with my anchor, okay.
Correct.
So that's a good portal. So I'm going to exchange this with a rod, okay.
Yeah.
So I'm going to secure the portal with my rod, and the needle comes out. The inferior needle comes out.
Yeah, you did not prefer to puncture the capsule.
No,
with
I did a capsulotomy.
Yeah, yeah. You did not prefer it to do it with your Wissinger rod.
No.
Yes.
So because I'm going to put a 8.5 cannula, so either way I'm going to get a tight fit.
Correct.
Okay, so this is my rod here.
Yes.
Okay, which is nicely showing, give me a nice angle of attack for my anchor.
Yes. Yes.
For my entire pathology.
This trajectory
anterior.
Has to be good. If this trajectory is wrong, then the whole surgery
step
can
nine,
go wrong.
Step
and
second
you can
step
keep struggling there.
Second step. So if I was doing a superior labrum, my direction would have been more proximal. Because
right.
I'm doing a bank cut, I'm going to do distally directed.
Correct.
So now I'm going to secure my anterosuperior portal. Same way, my needle goes parallel to the.
Yes. And you enter, I think your needle has to be, it's going into the, biceps tendon,
Okay, just a minute.
Just be careful,
yeah.
Push it inside a bit more. Yeah, now take the portal.
Mihir, have you kept anything in the axilla to distract the joint?
As of now, Abhinay, but I will do it when I'm working at 5 o'clock, 6 o'clock position. As of now, I'm just in standard distal traction rod. Stab knife again. I've not done a capsulotomy, so I'll do it.
Here it is very important to do the capsulotomy.
And because
otherwise,
because I'm very close to that biceps tendon,
yes,
I need to be a little
more,
slower.
Yeah, it's very easy to otherwise cut the biceps tendon. So here, if you observe, he is keeping his scope very much near
there, okay?
To the
so I'm as accurate.
Point. Yes.
I'm as accurate.
Yes.
That should be good enough. And I will not twist my blade when I'm in soft tissue, otherwise
Correct.
The blade is going to break.
Yes.
See, these blades are good to push and pull out. They will not take torsion.
Yes.
Okay? So, just a minute, we'll just do that.
See, time given here is very, very important because these are the most important steps of surgery. If you struggle there, then you are going to struggle all your surgery.
Yeah, so I've got my established my portal exactly where I wanted. And as far as I think, this is the first most important step besides preparation. I feel fixation is the least important step.
Yes.
Okay, because once I make my portals, I can see. And as I told you in the morning surgery, surgery is about seeing. If you can't see, you can't operate. Okay, I've established my antero superior portal. And you see, it's far away from the biceps tendon. Okay. This is the tone labrum where it starts. There is no labrum here at all. So it must have all medially migrated. Let me see what I do about it.
Yeah.
Okay, so now I'm going to start dilating the portal serially. Okay.
Yeah.
So what I do, I have these steel cannulas. Steel cannula.
So you're going to use a steel cannula.
Yeah. Yeah, so I use this steel cannula, 5.5.
Okay.
I don't use this, but I use it as a dilator. So it's just going to gradually keep increasing my capsular rent and keep spreading the deltoid fibers. Okay, so I'm just going to go in there. Okay. So that's my first 5.5 dilation. Then I'm going to dilate with the 8.5 cannula obturator. Okay.
Yes.
So the 8.5 cannula obturator, the diameter is about 6.57. So I'm gradually just dilating it. Okay, that's my obturator now. And now I'll go with my 8.5 cannula.
Okay.
So I use a needle, I use a blade, I secure with a rod and I gradually dilate it. Okay. Stab knife. Stab. So what I want to tell the delegates that more than seeing the repair of Bankart, what is important, you need to see the steps of the procedure, not the Bankart per se.
Correct.
Okay. You need to see how you make the portal.
See,
you need to
this
see.
He has enlarged this portal size because otherwise he won't be able to negotiate the 8.5 cannula from the skin. So that skin incision, he just increased a bit. So now he will be able to. put the cannula easily.
Yeah, go in. I hold the rod from here. Yeah. You up skin negotiate kar do. Yeah. So this is a screw in anchor. Screw in cannula. I always use screw in cannulas because they don't back out.
Yes.
Easy. Counter.
Are these cannulae available indigenous?
Yes, they are. But you have to understand these cannulas can be reused. I reuse them for a lot of cases. Yeah, keep going. See, what is important is Dr. Jairam is inserting the cannula, but I am controlling the rod.
Correct.
So I am keeping the rod away from the glenoid. Otherwise, the cannula insertion will damage the cartilage there.
Yes.
So we've got the insertion now. We'll remove the rod. We'll remove the obturator. The obturator out. Just pull it out. Pull it out. Yeah. Okay. So we've got a good cannula. I'll just back out. Just one thread is what I'm going to keep there.
Yes.
And you see, it's looking at my pathology. Beautiful. See this?
Yeah.
It's looking at my pathology and right. It's all locked. I'm pulling it. My whole joint is moving, but my cannula is not coming out.
Fantastic.
Okay. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to shift my scope to this portal. Now the problem is I can't see down there. Now you can see this band, the inferior glenohumeral band here.
Correct.
Fayaz?
Yes.
Give me a probe, please. Probe. So I'll just go through a diagnostic. This is the biceps tendon.
Yeah.
Okay. Which is nice and stable. See, I'm just pulling it down from the groove. A little inflamed, but structurally intact.
Correct.
Okay. That's my bicep tendon. This is tendon of the subscapularis.
Yes.
Okay. There is, I can't see any middle glenohumeral ligament here. Usually we see a nice
so you have to reconstruct that.
Yeah. And this is the anterior band of the inferior glenohumeral ligament.
Yes.
Okay. Axilla, please. Okay.
Just show where otherwise had this MGHL been
so the
there.
MGHL starts somewhere from the superior pole of the glenoid.
Right.
It goes like this and it goes at 45 degrees to the subscap tendon.
Correct.
And goes and inserts into the humeral. It's a gleno to humeral ligament.
Correct.
So you have a superior glenohumeral ligament which is almost insignificant.
Correct.
Then we have a middle glenohumeral ligament and then we have an inferior glenohumeral.
Correct.
And this is the anterior band of the inferior glenohumeral ligament. The
correct.
Posterior band will be behind.
Right.
So and you can't see it because it's torn and migrated medially.
Right. Right.
Now the issue is I can't operate from here. As I said, we need to see it to operate it. So I'm going to shift my scope to where this rod is.
Yes.
So then I can see it straight down.
Right.
Okay. So I'm going to shift my scope.
So you are going to have this as viewing portal.
Yes. This rod as my viewing portal.
Rod as your viewing portal.
Okay.
And the portal in which at the moment your camera is going to be for suture shuttling.
Just parking.
Suture shuttling.
Okay. So this is glenoid. This is humeral head. This is the supposedly part of the anterior labrum. This will be 6 o'clock.
Yeah.
This is the embryologic center of the glenoid.
Correct.
So I measure from ear to ear and I can adjust how much bone loss we have. Okay,
yeah.
I'll show you when from the top.
Yeah.
And this is the superficial. There is no slap.
So how
head.
Much
there
was
is
the bone loss in this case?
I don't think there is much, but I cannot comment now. I'll comment when I see from here.
Yeah. So do you have that cutoff thing or for
so anything up to 15-20% I'll do a soft tissue repair.
Correct.
Anything more than we have to put bone there.
Correct.
Which will be coracoid iliac crest, right?
Correct.
So you can ask the delegates whether you want to see any more anatomy. So this is a rotator cuff on the top. Okay, CHL. You can see this.
CHL. Coracohumeral.
See the coracohumeral is an
extra-articular structure.
It goes from the coracoid, which is extra-articular, to the acromion.
Correct.
Okay, so it is extra. So I need to open this rotator interval.
Yeah.
And I will do it when the patient is stiff.
Yeah.
Okay, stiff shoulders. We need to remove the coracohumeral ligament.
Correct.
Now this is the rotator cuff. Okay.
Yes.
The entire soft tissue behind this biceps is supraspinatus. Can you see?
Yes.
Supraspinatus. And as I go piche,
yeah,
that is infraspinatus.
Correct.
And then we'll go into teres minor.
Yeah.
And this is the bare area. I'll just remove that bubble. Just a minute. Give me a time. Yeah. The bubble is out.
Yeah.
So you see this bare area.
Yes.
So this is normal.
Yeah.
Okay. And then this would then form. This is the Hill-Sack lesion. See this?
Yeah.
This is Hill-Sack.
Yes.
Yes.
Touching the cartilage.
Yeah.
And this would be the bare area in the region of the cuff.
This seems to be a shallow Hill-Sack.
Yes, absolutely. Completely shallow. I think just chondral loss probably.
Correct.
And this is posterior glenoid. See this?
Yeah.
So this labrum at 7 o'clock is intact.
Yeah.
This is the posterolateral defect with the humerus. So we are rotating the humeral head.
Correct.
See the Hill-Sack is moving, right?
Yeah.
So it's absolutely shallow.
Correct.
This is the bare area and the rotator cuff is intact. And you
correct.
see the glenohumeral ligament. Beautiful.
Yes.
From the glenoid, they're going and inserting into the humerus.
Right.
So this is the way. I don't think you can see this anatomy other than arthroscopic.
Correct.
You cannot see this in open surgery.
Correct.
Okay. So you've seen the rotator cuff, you've seen
yes.
the bicep, the labrum,
yeah.
the subscap. Yeah, I think we'll start.
Can you show the posterior band of IGHL and where you look for Haggard lesions?
Okay. So now I've seen, we need here. Okay. So you see this prominence here?
Yes.
See this? That's the posterior band of the IGHL. See this? Let me see whether my probe can reach the right. Yeah, okay, there.
No, we can see it.
Can you
I
see this?
Pointing, yeah.
Yeah,
I
can you see this prominence?
Pointing, yes.
It starts from about 7 o'clock, 8 o'clock position there. and it goes up like that, like that, like that, like that, and goes in, and fuses into the capsule.
Yes.
And then goes into the humeral head.
Yeah.
So that's the posterior band. So the entire tissue from the posterior band to the anterior band is the hammock.
Correct.
Which supports or gives inferior stability to the humeral head.
Yeah.
Okay. So many times you'll get repair tears of the capsule from the humeral attachment, which what Shailesh was saying were Hagel lesions.
Right.
H-A-G-L, humeral avulsion of glenohumeral ligament. So you need to repair it there.
Correct.
Okay. So, the coracoid will be in this region. We are not going to open it now.
Yeah.
Okay. And we have very good cartilage. Okay. Any other anatomical structure you want to see?
I think we can proceed to
shifting.
Okay,
great. We'll shift. Okay. Yeah. Rod. So again, you have to understand, we need two rods always in any scopy.
Yes. To and shift. The company wala provides only one.
Yes. That's the problem. So you need to have it in your kitty. Yeah. Two rods.
Yes.
Okay. So now focus here. We make this the outside picture. I'll just show them. Okay, I'll just show them how we switch. So this, I want to shift my scope from here to here.
Yes.
So there is a way we need to do it. We can't just remove the sheath out. We're going to lose the portal.
Correct.
So I want to stop irrigation. I'm going to remove my scope.
Correct.
But I'm going to keep my sheath there. So my scope is, my portal is still secure.
Yes.
I'm going to put a second Weisinger rod. My first rod is here.
Yes.
So my second rod goes into this.
Yes.
So I've secured my rod. Secured my portal. Then my sheath comes out.
Yes.
Hold. So this is what I've done. I've kept both my portals secured.
Correct.
And then I'm going to shift to my anterior superior portal for viewing.
Right. Yeah. So how much is the depth when you put, you know that you are in the glenohumeral joint?
Number one, I get the giveaway of the rotator interval tissue, and second, irrigation fluid starts coming out.
Correct.
Okay. So now I'm going to remove this rod. I'm going to put my scope into it. I'm not going to remove this rod just now, otherwise I'll lose this portal.
Yes. So again, when you are putting it into your anterior superior lateral portal, that time you will see the Weisinger rod which is coming from your posterior portal.
Yes, true.
And then you are going to put your outside in cannula.
See, I've gone into the deltoid muscle. So there is a chance I'm not in the joint. Let me see. See the deltoid muscle?
No, I think you are inferior. Just come out a bit.
Yeah, that's why I'm just gradually withdrawing it. I'm gradually withdrawing. I don't know. Oh, probably I've lost it. Let's
see. Yeah, so now again you have to go back. So look, this is good that for our viewers, it is like...
I'm in the joint, Fayaz.
You're in the joint. You're more anterior.
I've not made a mistake, Fayaz.
Yes, good.
Okay, fine.
Good.
Yeah, so I'm in the joint. So you need to be patient. Yeah.
So that is what actually I was asking you, that how much is how much? When you're putting
it. Yeah, so that's my rod that is coming from behind.
Correct.
So now my orientation is going to completely change.
Yeah, so now you're watching superior. Upar se niche dekh rahe. Everybody's understanding? If somebody's not understood, just raise the hand. See, now you're watching from the head end of the patient. So your orientation has changed. So that rod is coming from posteriorly there. Okay. You are watching from superior aspect, and on the right hand side, this is the biceps tendon, this is the glenoid, that's the humerus, and from here, this side, your anterior portal is going to be there.
Okay, so again, now we are seeing from the top. So this is the humeral head.
Yes.
This is the glenoid.
Yes.
Now this is anterior.
Yeah.
And this is posterior, from where I entered initially. See this?
Correct. Correct.
This is post. So now from here, I can see my entire intact posterior labrum. See,
yes.
The labrum is intact.
Yes.
And this would be the biceps tendon here.
Right.
Okay, I'm just next to the biceps tendon. Now you can see the entire pathology.
Yes. So you were there inside, over there. Yeah.
So this, you see this attachment of the inferior glenohumeral ligament?
Yes.
There. So now you can see the pathology. Okay. And from here, you can even see the hill sac.
Yeah. Yeah. So probably we will not require anything.
No,
to be
nothing,
done for
nothing, nothing. That's correct. So we'll start now. So Maz is going to maintain this rod throughout, so I don't lose it. We're going to hold it there. And I'm going to start my preparation. Now the first step.
So now just tell what you're going to do step
wise. Yes, yes. So give me the first rod. Rod again.
Mihir.
Yes. Yes, Shailesh.
Before you put the anchor, can you show how the humeral head is subluxated, and when after putting the anchor, how it will be relocated?
Leave it. So Shailesh, it's almost relocated. It's almost centralized just now.
Hold it. How do you assess the hill sac lesion from anterior superior portal, and it gives you idea whether to put an
So what happens is many times the hill sac is engaging, as in when you go in, the humeral head is completely in this pouch here, dead space here, and that is, secondly, you need to do your calculations. Now in this case, hold this. I'm just trying to. I can't even see the hill sac. So I'm not going to even attempt it.
So when you cannot see it, then there is no obviously no
Absolutely,
need to
repair. Yeah, good. Okay, so now give me a probe or a rod. I'll just show them the pathology here. Yeah. So now for orientation, this is anterior glenoid face. This is the anterior neck here. Okay, this is neck. We need to prepare.
Yes.
This is the IGHL.
Yes.
This, see this? And it's all micrated medially. I need to put it
correct.
Up on here.
Correct.
Now the issue here is I don't see any capsular tissue at all.
Yes. So is it a deficient capsule there?
Yes, could be. I don't know.
So will you have to take the inferior capsule more superiorly?
So I'll be taking all these things into here. I'll be pulling this a little up.
Correct.
So I'll be doing a south to north shift.
Yes.
Okay, and an anterior to a posterior shift.
Yes.
Okay, so because this man has dislocated 10 to 15 times, probably the
deficient capsule
has completely gone off.
Yeah.
You see, I can actually see subscap muscle through this capsule.
Correct, correct.
Okay, so that is there.
Yeah. A bit of a tricky situation.
Abhishek here.
Yes, Abhishek.
Yeah. Can you now show us how we assess the bone loss, glenoid bone loss?
Yeah, so see, this is the embryological center. Can you appreciate?
Yeah.
Embryological center?
Yeah.
So you have to understand that the glenoid. The center means if I divide this distance into two, the two distance should be equal. This A should
right.
be equal to B.
Yeah.
So I need to measure from here to here.
Okay.
And that distance, I think in this case is almost equal.
Almost,
or probably
yes.
some bone loss. There is definitely bone loss.
Yeah.
But it's not significant. But what happens many times the bone here has, there is no bone beyond this.
Right.
Then you need to augment
right.
it with some kind of bone. So in this, this is the embryological center. For me, this is only a soft tissue repair.
Okay.
Okay. So no significant bone loss. And also you saw the heel sac is small. So basically, we are looking at a heel sac which is on track.
Yeah.
We'll discuss this afterwards. And minimal bone loss. So it's a simple
right.
soft tissue Bankart's repair.
Right.
Or a capsulolabral repair.
Yeah.
That's the generic word for Bankart's, okay? Fine.
Yes, Dr. Piyush here, sir.
Yes, Piyush.
Sir, do you believe in doing CT scan before
yeah,
surgery?
Yes, yes. So you have to understand, Piyush, the MRIs that we do nowadays, they give us a very good shadow of the bone. And even if I'm doing a Latage, I'm always going to do a glenoidoscopy.
Okay.
So my final decision is going to be on my calculation which I do on table.
But so on table, we can see only the affected side. So
affected side?
In preoperative CT scan, we can do bilateral and compare. So do you practice
okay.
that?
No, no, I don't do the other side. No, I've not done it. Because we have, I can do my calculations here itself. So if this is A up to here, and this is B from year to year,
okay.
A has to be equal to B in normal
yeah.
patient. In this case, A will be larger than B, which means there is some bone loss here. And I calculate the percent. And in this case, I know, I don't think it's more than 5%.
Right.
Yeah?
Right.
And can you tell us what is a pear shape and inverted pear shape?
So what happens is, okay. So what is the inverted pear? Now, we know a pear is narrow where the stem is, where it hangs from the stem. Jharse, when you break it, that stem is narrow there. And it becomes a nice ball distally, okay. So inverted pair may what happens, just imagine the normally a glenoid is broad inferiorly and narrow superiorly. So that's like a normally oriented pair. Now, but when there is bone loss here, the narrow path goes distally. So this becomes narrow and this becomes broad. So it looks like an inverted pair. So basically it's a colloquial word for bone loss antero inferior.
Yeah.
I hope I could get across.
Yes, yes.
Yeah, yeah.
Thanks, man.
I mean, or y'all could make a little diagram and show it to them what means by. So it's just a colloquial word for bone loss. Okay? So
yes.
We'll start now. The first step is elevating the soft tissue.
So Mihir, before you start,
yes, Aditya.
One thing I would like to tell for the benefit of the delegates.
Yes.
The Bankart repair is
elevator.
Not a labral repair, it's a capsulolabral
yes,
repair.
Yes, capsulolabral repair, that's
so,
right.
So
elevator,
you need
elevator.
To shift the capsule in addition to repair it, you need to remove the capsular redundancy. So that big pouch which is created there, you need to eliminate that. Just attaching the tissue there without doing a south to north shift of the capsule will not help the patient. He will again dislocate. So you need to retension the IGHL, that is the basic part of
yes.
doing the repair. So what he's doing is, he will elevate all that tissue there and get it to a higher position.
Okay, so Aditya, what I'm doing is now if I'm releasing the abnormal medial attachment.
Yes.
Okay, I'm going to release it and then pull it up and pull it proximally.
Yes.
So I'm going to do an anterior to posterior and more importantly, south to north shift.
Exactly.
Okay, so now I'm releasing, I'm keeping this periosteal elevator kind of instrument on the bone. And then my assistant is Dr. Jaram is gently going to hammer it. So you'll see it starts releasing, yeah. Go, go, go. So that?
Yes.
There's a nice sleeve of tissue which just goes off very nicely. And I'll do a very gradual. I don't want to create any iatrogenic bone loss. Yeah, yeah, go, 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 go. Go, 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 go. Yeah. Then I'm going to go around the corner. Go, please. So can you appreciate the release? Yeah,
yes,
great.
You can see
okay.
that.
So the angle of the elevator is towards the glenoid.
That's it. So I'm going to say I have two elevators. this elevator is going to take me around the corner and then I'll use my other elevator to do my release here. So I'm going to go almost tangential to the bone. Yeah, go.
Now your assistant must be elevating the
shoulder.
Yes,
my assistant is working very hard now. Yeah, see that? I've started separating it there. Okay, I'm still going to go beyond now. Yeah. Okay. Here again. Okay, so now this is free. This is elevated. This is elevated. This is elevated. Now I'm going to shift here. Okay. Yeah, hammer. Just one trick. You need to go absolutely skirting bone. Don't go here. Otherwise, you're going to cause damage to more soft tissue. Soft tissue is very valuable here. Yeah.
Mihir, this is Kaustu.
Yes, Kaustu.
So do you think you are beginning to actually see something like a labrum now, which you thought might was not there earlier?
Labrum? Yes, yes, I agree with you. I was just going to mention, see, I've started seeing some labral tissue here. So usually
in young patients, very often because the part of capsule you're seeing is actually the very lateral part of the capsule, which normally is not that thick anyway. And the actual medial part is gone much more medially.
See, we're actually seeing some kind of labral tissue there. See that? I need to pull the whole thing up. I'm going to release it thoroughly till I see the fibers of subscap. Hammer, please.
Please, sir, I'll just take your 10 seconds. If there is anyone left in for having lunch, please go and get it because we're going to close it shortly.
Fayaz, we are still starving.
Well,
Abhishek?
So you can take.
Well, that's the trade-off for being a surgeon.
Okay, I agree with you. Yeah, hammer, please. Okay, so I'm releasing it. And I'll see whether I can take it off. I just need to release it more here.
So Mihir, what's the end point of your release?
Yes, so I need to release it till I start seeing the fibers of subscap. Because subscap separates the capsule separates me from the subscap. So I can't still see it, but I can very nicely go down. If I separate it there and go there, there I can see the subscap fibers there. Can you appreciate just a minute? There. Okay? Can you see the subscap fibers there? So I'm going to still go down, release it. There. You can see the subscap fibers, a little dark brown. You can
see
red now. So what Kaustubh said is so true. You see this soft tissue, now you can see the labrum here or the capsule. So I'm going to try to pull it up. And this side you can see the raw bone. Okay, so I've released it right down. And this instrument is almost 2 centimeters. I'm going almost 1.5, 2 centimeters down. So I've done my release. I'll still need to go around the corner.
Okay, so after you release it, often you find it's quite stiff. It remains medial, doesn't come lateral.
True.
So what do you do for that?
So you need to extend the release into the surrounding normal labrum and the capsule and go a little more than the limits of what you feel is normal.
Absolutely. So that's exactly what you're doing now next.
So we need to extend it a little bit. Yeah, hammer there. So I can get a fibrous band there because there's a resistance there. Once I give you, I think the labrum will float up. Yeah, hammer. Okay, I don't think we need to worry about the axillary nerve. The axillary nerve is about a centimeter away. So we are way proximal to the axillary nerve. Hammer, please. Yeah, see now, suddenly it opens up. Saw that? It suddenly opened up.
Yeah.
Yes.
And now I'll take my retriever and try to pull it up. Blue handle. So let me see whether I can pull it up. See, I can pull it up. Beautiful.
Right.
Yes.
Beautiful. Excellent. Okay.
So what was looking like a deficient capsule
absolutely
ended up being
very
excellent quality tissue. And this is what you should expect every time. I think this is the norm rather than the exception.
Yes. So that I can actually now bring it up. So I've released the abnormal adhesions and I now can nicely. So now I've finished my preparation of the soft tissue. So now my next step is preparation of bone. So I'm going to freshen the bone because I want healing there. Rasp. So I'm going to use a rasp now. Yeah. So this is the rasp. I'll show you intra-articular only. So that's my rasp. Okay. It's a rough tissue. It's like the burr. So now we just gently hammer. Tuck, 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 tuck. Gently hammer. Yeah. Okay. Great. Once more. Once more. So I'm not causing further bone loss. I'm just trying to remove all the soft tissue.
So just for the benefit of delegates, which rasp would you use here? The upward or the downward?
So this is the downward turn. Let me confirm. Yeah, this is downward because I'm going around the corner. Okay, and then I'm going to shift to the upward one, yeah. And see my assistant, immediately I go to 5 to 6, he gives a little lateral traction. Yeah, and I'm going to change now to the opposite, the partner rasp, partner rasp. So this gives me a good angle here. Hammer, please. Hammer here. Hammer. Okay, now I'm going to take my shaver. Shaver, please. Another, no problem. Another. Suction out. So in shoulder, I don't use suction. Because the problem when I, so in the knee in the morning when we did the case, my shaver had a suction attached. What happens in shoulder, we are using an arthroscopic pump. So it's a closed cavity with a set pressure. Moment I use suction, the pressure goes for a toss.
Right.
Okay, so I don't use suction. But however, I keep the suction end open. Okay, fine. So I'm going to just go in forward mode. I'm not going to oscillate because I don't want soft tissue loss. See, what happens if I had to put my suction on, my soft tissue would have come into the shaver blade.
Exactly.
So I've kept my suction, I've kept my tap also off. Now the soft tissue doesn't come into the window. I'm just going to go in a straight mode. Rod piche. Don't get it out. Let it be. So I'm just polishing the bone, getting all the fibrous tissue out. And again, my shaver window is away from the soft tissue because soft tissue is very important here. It's basically a soft tissue surgery.
So you are using your shaver in a continuous revolving mode.
Yes, it's not oscillating. So I said yesterday, oscillation is for soft tissue debridement. And whenever you're working a bone, you need in either forward or backward mode. Okay, Rod, let me see how my preparation is. Elevator. I'll just take the capsule away. Sir, I'm going to. So there, that's my prepared, just a minute, I'm just showing them. So I'm now going to use a burr there. Almost all the fibrous tissue is out of the neck, so I'll use a burr. That too in reverse mode, so I don't want bone removal, I just want to polish the bone. There, okay. Very lightly, not too much pressure. Shaver blade. Elevator.
Mihir, do you believe in curating of a margin?
No,
of the
I don't do that, Kaustub. So I have seen a lot of surgery. I don't do that because basically, just a minute. Yeah, let me see how my preparation is now. Sir, hold this instrument. Yeah. So now we've got good raw bone. Okay, there. See that? It's good raw bone.
Yes, excellent preparation.
Yeah. So this is what I want to see, and the BP is nice and 90. So I'm not going to get bleeding here. Okay. So I'll stop my preparation here now. So we prepared a soft tissue, we prepared a bone, and there we can see the subscap inside. Just if I take this further away, you'll be able to see the subscap there. But I'm going to work hard. I've got my release done.
Yeah, that's fine. Okay. We believe you.
Yes,
once you
right.
reduced it, it's done.
Yeah, yeah, that's right. So once we got the reduction, that's fine. So now things change for me. I'm going to go back to the posterior portal here. Okay, so I do my release seeing from anterior, but my instrumentation I'll do working from posterior. Okay, so this is where I'm a little different. I think most of you all will keep your scope here and finish the procedure here. Correct, Kaustubh?
Yes, we would.
Yeah, so somehow it's just again a matter of habit. However, to the delegates, you can continue and finish the procedure keeping the scope here. But I shifted behind because I want to see the instruments coming end on towards me.
And the other advantage of doing that is that you can use the anterosuperior portal to grab the...
Yes, agreed. But again, it's a matter of choice. Again, it is a matter of your training. What is important is you have to follow the principles, right?
Absolutely.
So again, two rods. I'm shifting my sheath posteriorly again. Because that is the reason I can maintain the rod there. Camera. And now I'm going to secure the anterior superior with the cannula because that is going to be my parking portal.
Yes. So you use metal cannula?
No. I will be using a plastic one. A clear cannula. Okay, so we're back where we started with. There, okay. So now we have the labrum coming up. So now I'll plan my repair, axilla. I'll plan my repair. So my plan is, just a minute, there. So we knew that tear is still about 6. I'm going to keep my first anchor at about 5:30 o'clock position.
Good.
That's where I'm going to put my first anchor. There, yeah, perfect.
Excellent.
My next anchor would be around at 4:30 o'clock, and then at about 3 o'clock, and then I'll see whether I need anything on the top. So 3 anchors for sure. Okay?
Absolutely. So 3 anchors minimum.
Yes.
For,
and I'm going to use all suture anchor, because that's my favorite angle for glenoid repair. Okay, and you see already, now suddenly you can see there is capsule, right?
Exactly. So
suddenly
all the capsule
there
was
capsule.
There, but
beautiful.
It was medially. And
yeah,
you couldn't
relax,
see it. That
relax,
was the
relax.
Only thing. And perhaps you may even find an MGHL now if you look for it.
Okay, so 5.5.
Meer, do you use double loaded or a single loaded anchor?
So my first anchor is going to be double loaded.
Mm-hmm.
No, stab knife. My first anchor is going to be double loaded because I want one to go from south to north. And one to go from anterior to posterior.
Okay.
And also, this is the most important anchor.
So you are going to do what is called as a pinch and tuck.
I think so. I don't know the name, Aditya. Yeah. Go.
You prefer to take simple sutures, both of these?
Yeah, both of them simple. No mattress. So everything is simple. That answers the question, Kaustubh?
Yes, yes.
You mean mattress? Yeah, the simple suture.
Yes, that's what I meant.
We just push it a little bit. Just a minute. Yeah, there. Hold this. So we just take it out a little bit. Second rod. See the tissue, capsule tissue already visible.
So that demonstrates the importance of an adequate release.
Yes. Release, see, I am operating from behind just now, but for release, you have to see from the front. I think that is the most important part of surgery. Okay, so there were times when I used to do my entire surgery from here, and then I shifted, and it really made a difference to the kind of results I get. Okay, so I have two portals now. This is going to be my 8.5 working through which I'm going to take my sutures and put my anchors. And this is going to be my suture shuttle portal, or my I call it the parking portal.
So what size is that?
This is 5.5 because no instrument is going to go in through that. And this portal is 8.5 because my suture passing instrument, the arc, is about 6 to 6.5 mm. So I'm going to use an 8.5 portal here.
Yes.
Okay, so now I'll first fire my anchor here. I'm going to use an all suture anchor double loaded. Double loaded Iconics. So, Kaustubh, we had a talk about anchors. I think Nikhil, no, I think you are taking talks on the anchor, right?
Yes, my talk on anchors is done.
Great.
So one of the advantages, as I said, for the all suture anchors is that you can actually use a curved guide
yes,
for this last,
yes, yes.
last anchor.
That's right. So if you see here, the outside picture, zoom in, reverse, yeah. So you see this guide is curved compared to a guide which is straight. See this is straight. See this?
Yes, we can see
so
that.
So this curve 12 degrees also very good for me to reach 5 o'clock without damaging cartilage.
Absolutely. And we know there's a significant incidence of the anchor actually going across
yes,
outside.
Yes, yes, yes. So I always use this curved all suture anchor. Second thing gives me a very small hole. And thirdly, I can put more anchors. Anchor ready? Anchor ready? Yeah, anchor ready. Fine. So now we'll hammer. So now I'm going to, okay, just a minute. Yeah. Perfect. Thanks, Mas. Obturator out, sir. Obturator out. So all these sleeves have these slits here, okay? So you can see on the monitor where your anchor is progressing. There. Kausu, that's good?
Yes, excellent.
Okay.
That's
okay.
About 5:30.
Yes, yes. So I'll just hammer it and tap it into place. Now you have to understand all suture anchor needs a good cortical shelf. So I can't hammer very strong like what we do in a titanium anchor, okay?
Yes.
I need an intact cortical bone, just a gentle tap. That's it. So that locks my sleeve. So that sleeve got locked there.
Absolutely. So it's basically in the cartilage that you anchor it.
Yes. I think I can go a little more distal. Yeah.
Hammer.
Okay. I don't want to break that cortical bone because my entire all suture ankle is surviving on the cortical bone. Just a minute. Just
absolutely.
A minute.
Bone quality is
tap,
very important
tap, tap.
For all suture anchors.
Yeah. Perfect. Perfect. So I've got into the cartilage and I'll see the anchor going through this notch there. Okay. Straight
yes.
drill till the stop. Straight drill, yeah. So you see, drill in, drill in, drill. Drill, 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 yeah, go. There, my drill bit has gone in. touch bone, drill in, go in. Yeah, go drill. Yeah, full. Idhar tak, pura touch ho jayega. Go.
So is the drill bit also a flexible one?
Yes, it's a flexible, it's like a K-wire, a flexible one, out.
So very thin drill.
Yes, out. So this anchor is 2.3 mm final diameter of the anchor before deploying. Show the anchor. Can you all see the anchor?
No. Yeah,
there.
Now we can.
So it is only suture, okay? There is no titanium, there is no peak.
Yes.
And that braided material is going to become a ball. So it inserts at 2.3 mm and it goes inside and becomes almost 3.5.
Okay.
So now, go in straight. No rotation, yeah. And push it. Yeah, and now little hammer. Gentle. Go. Go. Hammer. Yeah, so it's going in. Okay, so I'm deploying it. Go in. Pura touch. Full touch. Great. Okay, now dislodge the threads. Okay. And just separate it out and pull the stiletto, pull the inserter out. Okay, so we fired the anchor. I still have to activate it. Activate it means I want to increase the diameter. Okay,
right.
Hold the camera.
Right, so is that just by pulling out or is
there
some mechanism?
Yes, I'm just going to draw the threads. Okay, so I'm going to remove this. It's still not active, okay? It's not still not a ball. It's still 2.3 mm. Hold this. So what I'm going to do is, I'm going to take the corresponding pair, that is dark blue to dark blue, and I'm just going to draw the threads, okay? Okay, when I do this, it becomes a ball inside and it's going to get locked
right
under the subchondral bone. And that is why viability or maintaining the subchondral bone is important. And that is why, I avoid scooping out cartilage, because many times that cortical bone goes off with it.
Absolutely. And usually, a lot of healing actually is happening from the capsule to the neck.
Right. So you see this now, the whole limb is moving. I'm holding just one of the double loaded suture.
Right.
So we got a good now. Now this is a double loaded anchor. So I'm going to start my repair. So first I'm going to take one thread to me, blue handle.
Mir, what company anchor is that?
This is Iconic Striker 2.3 mm double loaded. However, all companies have these anchors.
Yes.
Okay, you see this is on the face. It's about 2 mm onto the face.
Yes.
I don't want it on the edge.
Right.
Okay.
Any specific reason?
Because if you see the labrum comes on the face here, a normal labrum comes on the face.
Okay.
Okay, so I want it on the face and not on the edge. The second reason, if I make it on the edge, the whole of the anchor, one wall will be open. The anchor will just slide off anteriorly.
Correct.
So you want it on the face, you want an intact tube in which the anchor is going to lock.
Right.
So I'm going to use the dark blue. So this is suture management. Nikhil must have spoken about this.
Yes.
And everything in shoulder is suture management, okay? So I'm going to take a single blue. And when I'm pulling, I'm seeing over here.
Right.
Okay, it should not draw over there. That means the anchor should not dislodging. Okay, so I have three there and one here. See this?
Yes.
So now I'm going to take my suture passing device. I'll just show the suture passing device here.
Yes.
Outside vision, please. So I think Fayaz, you spoke about suture passing. And this is one of the primitive instruments.
Yes.
This is an antegrade kind of instrument. It has a little wheel here.
Yeah.
So I pass it and as I do it. This
retrograde.
So this is retrograde. I'm sorry. Okay.
Yes. So as he's moving the roller, the suture comes out.
Now this is the most important step and also the most difficult step.
Yeah.
Okay, so I'm going to go beyond.
So now
where
we want to see how you're going to take the inferior most with this.
Yeah, so first is vision.
Mihir, do you use a scorpion for the inferior most if at all you need to shift?
No, I've never used it yet. I have it in my box.
Yeah.
Because I think I can control. So what I'm going to do is, this circle of this passer is about 10 mm.
Right.
So I'm going to keep it here.
Yes.
So my bite is about 8 to 10 mm distal to where the anchor is inserted.
Correct.
So when I tighten it, this tissue actually gives me a south to north shift.
Correct.
Okay. So, and I'm going to go about 10 mm away from the glenoid. So it gives me anterior to posterior shift also. I'm not going to take a bite here. I'm going to take a bite there. Okay.
Is the position of bite is something to do with the anterior band of IGHL?
Sorry, position of?
Bite which you are taking is something to do with the anterior band of IGHL, where you want to be inferior to IGHL?
I did not follow you, Shailesh. I'm so sorry.
I mean, the anterior band of IGHL.
Yeah.
Would you like to go inferior to that? I mean,
I have gone through it.
Yeah. Just for the sake of delegate, where you have to take a bite. You have to go to distal to the IGHL.
I think what he's trying to ask you is how you do a capsular shift. Inferior to superior.
You want to reconstruct the anterior.
I got. I'll show you. I'll show you. No, I understood, Shailesh. Sorry. Hold this. Okay. Now hold this, sir. Hold this. Hold this.
Mihir, I have one question.
Yeah.
So how do you prevent any nerve injury in that area?
Okay. So if you see, give me a rod or a probe. Huh. So keep it distracted. Now see, I've taken my pass at about 5:30 o'clock position. Okay.
Right.
Now when this ethylene is going to come where my anchor is, so I'm going to get easily a south to north shift. You understood, Shailesh?
Yes.
Okay. My axillary nerve is a centimeter from the labrum here.
Yes.
So if I puncture here my axillary nerve, so my axillary nerve goes off. So here there is no danger of axillary nerve.
Yeah.
The axillary nerve
yeah.
will be when I'm doing my capsular releases in this region.
Yes. Almost so 1.5 to 2 centimeters. You
secondly,
can say.
Because I'm using the older device, you know, that lot of tactile feeling is important. Moment I puncture capsule, it gives me a giveaway and I turn it immediately.
Correct.
So what happens in the scorpion is you don't have that tactile feeling and going to take everything. Then
right.
you could probably have the axillary nerve in. So this is so you see, my bite is a good tissue, and when I pull it, oh, it's ethylene pocket, just pull this. The, hold the ethylene, ethylene, ethylene. Hold the ethylene. When I pull it, pani, water is over.
Yeah.
It's
so when you're pulling it,
yes,
we can see
water,
the capsule
water.
Being
water,
being,
water.
Being shifted
yeah.
northwards.
So Fayaz, one more problem. Water gets over exactly at the most important time.
yeah.
But that is there everywhere. So no problem.
Yeah.
So in the meantime, I'll show you the shuttling outside picture. Outside picture. Yeah. Yeah. So you see this black ethylene?
Yes.
So that is the tissue, the thread which I passed through the tissue.
Correct.
And this blue fiber of the anchor is my final thread.
Right.
So I'm going to use the blue, black ethylene to act like a piggyback to take this blue with it.
Yes.
So I'm going to make a little loop. Okay, you see this simple loop? The blue one goes into the loop.
And a single knot, right?
Single knot. Because I wanted to come out as well. Nice and tight.
Yes, and what size of the ethylene is
it's
that?
It's a number one ethylene.
Yes.
It. Why ethylene? Because it is mono, this thing, it's not
braided.
Monofilament,
yeah.
So it passes very easily.
Correct.
Yeah, let the water come. Yeah, axilla.
Mihir, can you show how to take a dilating knot for the sake of delegate?
Sorry?
Dilating knot.
Dilating knot, okay.
Like before.
Okay, I'll do that. Okay, fine. Now
yeah,
I'll have to. Fine, I'll do that. Chalo. So I'll let this act like a dilating knot. Okay, so Shailesh, you're making me do something that I usually don't do.
And that too in the live surgery. You catch hold of it after the surgery.
Okay, I'll have to pull it more, just a minute. Mosquito, please. Mosquito. Scissor, just cut it off. Scissor.
You can use that as a dilating knot and...
No, but there's hardly any thread beyond it.
Okay.
Yeah, so I'll make the dilating knot close to where my cannula is. Okay, and my other knot will now have the suture. This is how Shailesh, you would normally do it. I usually don't do this.
Yes, yes.
Okay.
See, on a couple of occasions I have seen the... Thread has just come
so
out.
So what Shailesh meant is a good one. This first knot is dilation, so it creates a nice puncture, and this then carries the thread through. So then there will be no struggle at all. Okay. So now we'll see inside, and we'll just start pulling this. Okay. Now inside picture, please.
So now you are going to pull the black thread.
I'm going
thread
to pull the black.
And
that's
the
right.
Black thread is going to take your.
That's right.
Another thread along.
So my dilating knot has gone.
Yes.
And now my suture knot is going.
Yes.
Okay. And it has left my blue inside only.
Yes.
There, okay? Red handle.
So that is a small issue with using the ethylene per se.
So I have
still
it there.
There was
I
no
have
issue.
It there.
Yeah.
I have it there.
Yeah, you have it there. If it gets stuck in the tissue, then you have to redo it all over.
So that's my shift. See that? As I'm pulling it, the labrum is coming nicely onto the glenoid. There, okay?
Yes.
So
yes.
Now what I'm going to do, I'm going to so I pass and knot, blue handle, retriever. So I'm going to take the white tiger away now, because whenever you knot, remember one thing, don't keep any other thread in the cannula.
Correct.
So I'm going to take this partner away.
So now you have only two threads which are
yes,
to be tied
yes.
in that same
and
cannula.
And one more trick, very important. See, I don't know whether there are any tangles in the cannula. So what
yes.
I'm going to do, I'm going to go down each time and retrieve the suture from the base.
Right.
And come out. So now all my tangles will be out.
Correct.
And
so now there is no issue of not being prematurely tied in the cannula itself. once the tangles are out.
Yes, okay. Fine. So now we come to post and stand. Okay.
Yes. So now show us outside which one will be your post.
See, that the rule is the suture which goes to the soft tissue, in this case, this suture, this.
Away from the...
Yeah, so the suture which goes to the soft tissue is always going to be a post.
Right.
Because the post... Yeah, so...
The post is going to take the knot along with
it. Yes, hold the camera. So now, I'm going to keep it here. Now this picture. There, okay? So this thread, can you see this thread?
Yes.
Yeah, that's the one that went through the tissue. So that's going to be my post.
Yeah, how and did you know that?
Because I pulled it inside from there.
Okay.
Okay, and Dr. Jairam is keeping it taut. So moment he keeps it taut, you see the reduction there is already
occurring. So that is going to be your
post. So I'm going to keep it intact.
Right.
And my other strand is the loop, which is going to go around.
Right.
Okay, so I'm going to take my first throw. Okay, I'm going over the top.
So
okay.
You are not taking a sliding knot?
No. I have done over a period of time is I do everything the way I do in open surgery.
Okay.
So there is nothing different. I'm going to build the knot. No fancy knot. I'm going to build one by one.
Okay.
So I put my first throw there.
Yeah.
And now the post is this one.
Right.
Okay, which is straight.
Right.
So by definition, post is a strand which is kept straight and tensioned.
Right.
And the loop is one which is lax and goes around.
Absolutely.
Okay. Now, usually everybody would put the suture passer on this, knot pusher on this.
Yeah.
I put it on the loop.
Okay.
That's fine. That's completely again your choice.
Yeah.
So this is again where is the little difference. I'll just take it down and I'll seat the knot there. Can you see it? I just seated it there. See
there? Yes. So you are going to see that it remains there.
Yes. So I'm going to seat it there.
Yeah.
There. Okay. So the knot is away from the glenoid. Please understand. Again, very important.
Correct.
The knot bulk has to be away from the glenoid on the soft tissue side.
So that it doesn't cause knot arthropathy.
And you can already start seeing the labrum coming onto the glenoid, which was not there when we started.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
So now I'm going to come out. I've not tightened anything. The post is still the same.
Right.
Because I've not caused compression or reduction.
Yeah.
My next throw is also going the same direction.
Yeah. Show the outside picture bigger.
Outside picture, please.
Okay.
Again, same direction. Post is same.
Correct.
I'm going to go in the same throw from over under.
Right.
Same because I want compression.
Yes. So you are not going to change your
throw. Because I will change the throw, it will lock my knot.
It will lock your knot. Correct.
Okay, so now I'm going to go in again, same thing. Easy. Arms. Yeah. There. Okay. I'm going to go in. You see that the second one is inside. Now I'm going to keep it there.
Yes.
And I'm going to pull my post. It's going to tighten. See that?
Correct. Very good.
So I've got the reduction and then I'm going to pass point.
Yes. We will explain the delegates later on when the knot tying thing is there. What is pass point? Okay. So now this double knot is going to hold it there.
I have left everything and it's still holding.
Correct.
Okay. So I'm going to come out.
And then keep on throwing.
Yeah. So now I'm going to keep pass pointing. So I alternate my...
So under throw.
So two in the same direction.
Right.
Three in reverse.
Okay. So these are a bit knot tying techniques which we'll be showing you in the
Yeah, so we have a workstation, session. We'll have our faculty demonstrating to you live.
Yeah. You can see so nice capsular shift is being done from inferior.
And this is just the first of the two.
Yes.
And that to the first anchor.
Correct.
So I'm going to put a total of 5 half-inches.
Yeah. Now just a small hypothetical question for the benefit of delegates.
Yeah.
Supposing you have taken this first knot and you feel that there is some chance that I should have taken that second, the first one, first knot more inferiorly into the capsule.
Yes.
Can you also still go ahead and do the inferior?
Yes. The white tiger, I can still go inferior.
Yes.
So let me see. Okay.
So if you feel that this is too much superiorly, you can take the second bite from down and still shift the capsule. Yes. So total how many knots have you put?
2 straight, 3 reverse.
Okay.
Okay. So see, my labrum has come up.
Yes.
Okay. So now give me a probe.
Now you're going to cut off those strands?
Yes, I've cut it off already, Fayaz.
Good.
So that's going to be my knot there, okay?
Yeah.
In this soft tissue here.
Correct.
Nice and firm.
Yes.
And this is just the first one. So I'm going to put, let me see over here.
Yeah.
No, I think this is good. I'm going to go over here only.
Okay.
Let me see what we can do. Passer. Now I'll take, again, I'm going to take the strands. Now I'm going to work on the white tiger. So I'm just going to take this away. There, passer. So let me see whether I can go beyond it. Hold this. So I'll try to go beyond it, Ethanon.
Okay, but will you be able to see from the posterior portal?
Let's see. Hold this. Let's see.
So you want to go inferiorly more?
No. Only because that point came out, I am trying it. Otherwise, I would have gone straight the way we go standard. Okay.
Yeah. So what is your assistant doing at this point of time?
Oh, he's working hard. He's giving lateral traction.
Right.
Now suddenly the dead space is gone.
Yeah.
Okay, the dead space which we had is gone suddenly because we've got a good shift.
I think.
I'm just going ahead routinely now.
Yeah.
Okay.
Go routine.
Yeah, I'm going routine.
Yes. Because there doesn't seem to be any
space
there.
There is no space there.
Just
That's it. Great. Okay. This is tight. This is.
Is this tissue looking like this? Something to do with the pump pressure also?
I think so. I've released it, but then the tissue is not good.
Yeah.
But I'm going to incorporate everything into my repair.
Correct.
I'm just going to go beyond it.
Correct. So you have to save your subscapularis over here.
Yeah.
And how do you do that?
That's my subscap. See, my instrument is anterior to it.
Correct.
Okay?
Yeah.
So this.
So what is the trick here that you come exactly out from the same place?
Yeah. So what I've done is, after I pierce, the first step is pierce.
Correct.
Then I turn.
Right.
Then I skirt the prepared neck of the glenoid.
Right.
And I feel the neck of the glenoid just keep coming up till I get a give way.
Right.
Okay, so again we'll be shuttling. So now you understand, this suture, I have not gone beyond the anchor, I've just gone anterior, because
right.
This suture is only from anterior to posterior shift.
Correct.
So I'm going to come
out with
my hook.
First suture has done the job. So you can see how the suture has been shuttled now.
Yeah, so you're pulling it, yeah. That's right, you can go.
I go.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, great. So which one is it? Yeah. Pull the black out. Pull the black. Yeah, great. So see that?
Yes.
Okay, so this is giving me my anterior to posterior shift.
Yeah, and a good bumper effect.
Yeah, so now I'm going to again remove the tangles. Every time do it without fail. I'm going to hold this. This is the anchor. Hold. Mass, just hold it please, yeah. And this is my soft tissue.
So when you are removing the tangles, you can hold the both threads in one go, will it do then?
No, it will not remove the tangle, you need to remove separately. Because the tangle will go through a suture retriever.
Okay.
The tangle will go through the suture retriever, okay? Okay, so now again, my post is going to be the one which is going through this, right? Yeah, hold this straight. So we are holding it tight. Tip. Again, same one. There, okay, see that? Piyush?
Yes, sir.
That's good?
Yes.
There, we got a good bump. So my post is being maintained by Dr. Jairam. I am taking my first two reduction half inches in the same direction. So that is going to reduce, might see the compression I'm getting? And then Dr. Jairam is just going to relax, so I'm going to pass point and lock it. Okay, so it's locked. Okay? Fine. It's locked now. Now I'll reverse my post. I'll just show you that. I'll just take one more. Mars, relax. Deepak, show me. So I've reversed my post.
So we can see very nice bumper effect over there.
Yes.
So that bump is going to help us.
And the surprising thing or probably the expected thing that Kaustub said, you know, the release is so important.
Yes.
We started with imagining there is nothing, what will we do?
Correct.
And the moment you release it, you could see everything coming up from the medial side.
Correct.
The last now. Cut out please. So now I will decide whether I need a double or a single loaded anchor. So we'll be teaching you what is knot security, we'll be teaching you what is a good knot, what is a bad knot. Because I think knotting is one of the most difficult things for beginners to learn. And also the only thing, or probably the most important thing, under surgeon's control. So this is the cord cutter, okay? So the good thing about this cord cutter is it cuts here, 2 mm away. So I just keep it on the knot, I tighten it, and I cut it off. So I get a good 10 mm tail. There, so you see that labrum, labrum is up. Now I'm going to use a single loaded anchor here.
Yeah.
Okay? Because I don't need double loaded, keep it pulled like this. Yeah. Single loaded. So the difference between Bankart's repair and rotator cuff repair is Bankart's, the points of insertion are important and rotator cuff convergence is important. Give me a blue handle. I'll just see how much time. Retriever. So all this is a tissue which I can still lift up there. So that?
Yes, nice.
So we have some tissue here.
Yeah.
And this is my ultimate aim. I need to get this back.
Yeah.
Okay. So we'll, I think, 1 year and one single loaded year when we can call it a day.
Yeah.
So Fayaz, what we'll do is, I'll put the next single loaded anchor.
Yeah.
We'll just repeat all the discussion and then we can cut off.
Yeah.
Okay?
Yeah. Do you have penetrators there?
Penetrators?
I mean, for something like a bird beak?
Yes, I have. You want to show single loaded.
When you put the single loaded, you can demonstrate single that loaded. If at all it is possible.
Okay. I think I'll demonstrate it on the back trolley.
No. If at all, it's, no problem.
You and Shailesh are making me difficult.
No, not really.
No, I'm just joking. Okay, so now again, I'll go as close as possible.
Yes.
Let's say a single loaded system, which I'm going to use now. Again, I'm just seeing that we are about 2 mm on the face.
How much farther from?
As close as possible, but at the same time, I don't want to converge the holes.
Okay, and how do you secure the cannula in place?
It's a threaded cannula.
This one.
This one? Okay, so I'm just going to give a nice gentle tap.
Yes.
Just a minute, yeah. A gentle tap, so and you see it going into the cartilage. Yeah. Gentle tap. That's it. It's locked.
That's it. Yeah.
I don't want to break subchondral bone because that's very important for the anchor to hold in. Single loaded.
Yeah.
Drill. So there, that needle thing comes in. Yeah. Drill, please. Drill. Yeah. Go. Full throttle. Drill touch. Yeah. Yeah. Out. Anchor. So this push-in anchors have advantages and disadvantages.
So you see to it that your cannula doesn't move at all, and that's the reason.
No, my sleeve. Push it with hand first. It cannot move. Yeah, fine. Now hammer. Yeah. So I push about 2 mm of the anchor by hand, and then we hammer it inside.
Right.
So then you don't lose the track. Hammer. Yeah, great.
Mr. Abhishek here.
Yes, Abhishek.
Yeah, so we are looking at the pilot hole and making this decision about, you know, how far the distance should be. Because the inside, the inner part, the anchor forms the, so the suture forms a bulbous structure. So.
I was just paying attention to something else. Yes. Yeah, yes,
so
Abhishek, go ahead.
Basically, we are saying that the anchor, the pilot hole is small.
Yes, exactly. Yeah,
but inside, the whole anchor forms, so the suture forms a...
A ball.
So then how do you judge the distance between two anchors? Because what you see from outside and what is there inside
correct,
is different.
Correct. So I'm using the sleeve.
Yeah.
And sleeve is more than the diameter of the anchor. So moment I have my sleeve which is away, it automatically is going to be safe. Secondly, you have to understand, we are drilling from the same point at different points distally.
Yeah.
So automatically you're going to get divergence.
Right.
You understand? So that is another advantage we are getting. So usually it's not a problem that is created. So again, see, this is a single loaded anchor. We have activated and I'm moving the anchor and the whole limb is moving. This is how you test all your anchors.
Yeah.
And this is going to increase your confidence very much. So if you put a push in, screw in, put it and it will move it like that.
Correct.
So that's good hold. So now I'm going to repeat the same thing. I'm going to take one away. I'm going to take this one which is going to go through the tissue into my parking portal. And then I'm going to use a suture passing device. You see, the entire labrum has floated up.
Yeah.
And this time the bite I'm going to take is going to be right from the subscapularis tendon I'm going to take.
Mihir, suppose while pulling the
threads, the anchor comes out, then what will you do?
As in the all suture anchor?
Yes.
Oh, you need a rescue anchor all the time, Shailesh. So, this anchor is 1.4 mm diameter hole. Okay.
Yes.
So, if this anchor comes off, I cannot put the same anchor again.
Yes.
So, that is out. So, I have to put some other anchor. So, my rescue anchor is always a 2.8 mm anchor, or I will put a double loaded in the same hole.
Okay.
Okay. So, what I'll do, I'll take a nitinol wire. I have nitinol wires in my bag. Sorry, in my box. I put a nitinol wire. I take the double loaded sleeve on the nitinol wire and I hammer it into place. The nitinol wire comes out.
Okay.
I drill with the concern drill and then push in a double loaded anchor. Or the best thing is a titanium screw in anchor.
Okay.
A titanium screw anchor will use that same hole as a pilot hole. So you don't need to do anything extra. You just need to push and twist the angle inside.
So basically whenever we are using all suture anchor, we must have a
yes,
anchor with
you
us.
Have to have a rescue anchor. And I think I heard Kaustubh talking about it, and that's a very important point. All these fashionable anchors are good, but finally, if everything fails, the old generation titanium and loaded anchors are only going to come to your rescue. See, what I'm doing is, this is subscap tendon. Okay, can you see this?
Yeah.
Yes.
So I'm going anterior. I'm seeing I'm not penetrating. I'm going to go deep, deep, deep. And then I'm turning it, so I'm hitting bone. And there I come. Saw that? So I've taken all this bulk. We'll just check whether that's good tissue. I think that is reasonable. Shailesh, reasonable?
I think I can't see the labrum.
Yeah, looks good.
Okay, we'll see. Chal. Shuttle. I have one more anchor after this, so let's see. Yeah. Okay. Nice. Now you see a little tangle happening there, see this?
Yeah.
Yes,
you
yes.
don't want that tangle to occur, so I'm going to pull off this thread from out of it. So these tangles are which will reduce your knot security. I'm going to pull this out from here, make this tight and then go back and pull it out, okay? So whenever you get a tangle, there's nothing to worry, you just go toward the base of the anchor and solve it there. So that's a soft tissue, that is. Yeah, correct. Fine. Keep it like this. Okay, so I also remove the tangles by doing that. Hold, knot pusher. So again, post, return this piece, cut the knot off. Yes, sir. Yeah, that's it. Like this. Yeah. So I think we've got good tissue.
Yes, excellent tissue. Excellent tissue.
I think we've got some good tissue, and I have one more anchor above it.
Actually, I am used to do this surgery with the antero superior portal.
So the view is different.
View is different.
So good, all of us are learning something. So I've always done this.
Yes.
Yes, so the view from superior is different, I agree.
So now when you are tying the knot, I can see the labrum coming up.
So what I'll do is, again, I'll go in the superior portal and we'll see how it looks from there.
So while tying the first two knots,
yeah,
how much is sufficient pressure?
Pressure?
On the, when you're pushing the, pressing
yeah,
the knot
so
on the tissue,
basically
how much?
Once the soft tissue opposes, so visually the soft tissue to oppose bone.
Right.
Okay, and you don't want to pull the anchor out.
So it should not be too much and too less.
No. Exactly. So, Fayaz, again, you know, this is what I say. This is something that you have to develop over a period of time.
Correct.
It's like asking you when you're closing your IT surgery, IT band, how much tightness you have to do.
Correct.
You only have to do it to know it.
To know it, right. Nice.
So, I'll put one more single loaded and I think I'll call it a day there then.
So,
yeah.
Mir.
Probably
what was suggested was, in a bank cut, you keep it slightly more tight, the first knot, compared to a rotator cuff, where you don't put a lot of tension on the first knot.
First knot. Okay. I'm not aware of that. So you want bone to soft tissue to bone opposition, so you need to go. See, probably rotator cuff, you don't want to really push pull where the anchor is going to come off. you're working in osteopenic bone.
Exactly.
I'm not worried of pull out because it's strong bone, they're young patients.
There are two aspects. I mean, one is the strong bone in the glenoid, and the tissue here is going to be better compared to the rotator cuff. Is going to be a friable tissue.
I agree with you.
So the first knot in a rotator cuff generally is not, I mean, like, oh, bilkul khinch ke type se nahi karna hai. That's what
so Aditya, you would do a double row in all cases, single row in all cases, or you decide?
Depends. So if it's a retracted tear,
anchor,
if,
single rotator,
if the
valve karab,
rotator cuff is not coming easily to the footprint, I'll do something like a square row.
Okay, blue
if
handle.
The rotator
blue handle.
Cuff is easily coming to the footprint, it would be a double row repair.
Okay, so what happens is when I know I'm doing a double row, I'm really not worried too much about the knot tightening.
Yes,
because finally
yes.
I'm going to incorporate into the lateral row.
Definitely.
Yeah, so that is one security. But when I'm doing a single row, you know, those retracted tears which will not come back, then we need to be very careful. So
yes,
I think now this is the last tissue bit that we have. I'm just going to pick up the whole thing and put it back here.
You think there is sufficient tissue?
Yes, I think so.
Okay.
So finally, for the delegates, it's going to be the same step. I'm going to put an anchor, take a tissue and tie it back. So Fayaz, I think we can switch off here.
Yeah.
You can continue your program.
Yeah,
the
so
next
it's
talk
going
is
to be the same
yeah.
thing that.
So my the
is
next
going to
talk
repeated.
Is actually mine, basics of knots.
Okay.
So you could just
hello sir,
yes,
me
yes,
sir, Ganesh
yes,
here.
Yes, Ganesh.
Meanwhile, we'll finish other talks.
Yeah,
Dr. Ankit is here.
Oh yes, yes.
Yeah.
So we have the MRI talk still to go.
Yes.
Yeah, and
MRI.
And when you are done with this knot, for the delegates to see, we would like you to switch only your scope and keep the sheath there itself with the inflow on from the superior portal.
Okay.
Anterior superior lateral portal to show how nicely you have repaired it.
Yeah, okay, I'll do that.
So that now also we can see after all repair.
Drill.
Or else
drill,
without too much of demonstration, I think you'll be finishing this step in probably 3 odd minutes.
Yeah,
so we can wait for 3 minutes more.
Okay, chalo. Anchor.
Yeah.
Anchor.
So till then, just one comment about the cuff which we were talking about. I think vascularity is very important in the cuff.
Right.
So over tightening sutures in a cuff is actually not desirable.
Yeah.
And particularly if you're doing a double row, definitely you should not, because the sutures are actually cutting onto the cuff in that way.
Yeah, Anchor. So again, single loaded. Push it. Yeah, push it with hand first. Yeah, that's it. Draw it. Yeah, so the ball is made. We have good hold, blue handle. Sutura passer. So shoulder is all about repair and knee is all about reconstruction. Hold this. Yeah, go. So again, a little tangle. Oh, that's fine. No problem. Chill, not pusher. So I will see. So now what has happened? We've lost which one is which. We'll see. No problem. This is the suture anchor. This is the suture anchor. Yeah, chill, hold. This is the post, yeah. Yeah, right. Keep it like that. Yeah, that's right. Not pusher. Just a minute. Pro, please. I'm just checking. I feel the bite is not good enough. No, it's good enough. Yeah. It's good. There. Straight. Oh, the knot has also come with it. Needle. Money with needle. Cut off. So now we will rod. Rod.
Mir, you don't need to shuttle it.
Sorry?
What you do is keep your cannula in the posterior portal and just take your scope out so that your inflow is there.
Okay. So I always learn things from Fayaz. I thought my 6.5 sheath will not go in 5.5, but I did not realize I can get the scope go.
Only scope you can.
Yeah,
put
agreed,
it.
Agreed, Fayaz, I agree with you. Just give me a minute, I'll do that. That's a good idea. I'm gonna occlude kar dena. Sheath ko occlude kar de. Yeah. Okay. So. Pani on kar. Yeah. Thoda sheath ko piche le le. Yeah. So that's a repair. Okay.
Yes.
So initially you could see the entire defect.
Yes.
There was no labrum and now we have the entire labrum there.
Yes, excellent.
Yeah, so
fantastic.
I think this is a relatively good job. We done a good job. Whatever we could do, we've done.
This is nice.
Okay,
this
so we've done
good.
An anterior labral repair. Fantastic.
Correct.
It's well
yeah,
centralized.
And the head can be centered. We can see
yes,
in the center.
Yes, no issue there. And we've not done much scuffing. My glenoid is almost intact. Here, probably some scuffing has occurred. But
okay.
I think that's fine.
That's
probably
okay.
A great
non-weight bearing joint.
Yeah, so Fayaz, I'll cut off from here.
Yeah.
You all can continue.